The Obama administration says Cuba has completed the release of 53 of its political prisoners as part of last month's historic deal to begin normalizing relations with the U.S. The 53 on the list were cited by human rights organizations as being imprisoned for promoting political and social reforms in Cuba. Joining me now is Deputy Spokesperson for the U.S. State Department, Marie Harf. Marie, good to see you. Thanks.
Thanks for having me.
Thanks. What conditions were these political prisoners set free under?
Well, these were all on a list of people we had put forward to the Cuban government, people that were in jail for expressing freedom of expression, freedom of speech, things that are protected in almost every other country around the world. So obviously we were very focused on them being released and certainly hope that they will be able to go forward without intimidation. But just to be clear, Jose, as you know, this is certainly not the extent of the concerns we have about either prisoners or human rights in general. Very good sign that the Cubans have done this, but there is a lot more work to do.
What can you tell us about the timing, Marie, of this release happening just 1 week before the State Department's visit to Cuba? Why weren't they released sooner?
Well, some of them were released sort of on a rolling basis. We finalized the list with the Cubans last July and then obviously announced the whole deal in December after we had completed negotiations on the spy swap. So a couple of them were released over the summer. Some were released early in December, but then they've been released on a rolling basis. And look, regardless of why the Cubans chose now to take this sovereign decision to release them, we're glad that they did. And we'll keep pushing on those other prisoners that we believe should be released as well.
Marie, there were thousands of political arrests in Cuba last year, but the deal only includes 53 prisoners. What leverage does the U.S. have now to push for more changes on the island if all the deal has already been signed, sealed, and delivered?
Well, this is just the start of a much broader relationship here, as we've talked about, a different kind of relationship. These 53 prisoners were people we felt very strongly about, but I think one of the things we've tried to underscore over the past several weeks, and indeed since we announced the agreement, was that this is not the extent of what we care about. And we are, I'm sure, going to have many areas regarding human rights where we continue to disagree with the Cuban government. And that's why we believe we're actually more able to push these issues with the Cuban government. If we have a full embassy, if we have an ambassador, we will have more leverage if we're fully engaged. So that's what we're going to do, certainly. And there is much more work to do.
And in the Wall Street Journal's op-ed today, they do mention the fact that Cuban spies have been included in official delegations throughout the world. And here in the United States, there have been issues of Cuban spies being among delegations in the United Nations, et cetera. Are you concerned now that with the new opening of relations, we're going to see more Cuban spying in the United States? We've seen some pretty high-level Cuban spies found in the State Department and elsewhere. In the past.
Well, look, coming from my previous world in the intelligence community, spycraft is certainly not a new trade. We're always concerned about it. But I think really what this new relationship is based on, you mentioned the trip that's coming up, Assistant Secretary Roberta Jacobson is going to Cuba, is how we can better advance our interests and our values and have more leverage in Cuba. Look, all the things we've been concerned about for a long time, we remain concerned about. That hasn't gone away. We just believe the better way to actually promote our interest is to be engaged more, so that's what you'll see going forward.
Marie Harf, thank you so much for being with me. Good to see you.
Good to see you too, Jose.
And let me bring in Executive Director of Cuba Democracy Advocates in Washington, D.C., Mauricio Claver Caron. Mauricio, good to see you. Thanks for being
thank
with
you.
Me.
Thank you for having
so,
me, Jose.
Cuba released 53 political prisoners, some of them that have been there for years. Is this a good sign?
Well, obviously, we want to celebrate the release of these 53 prisoners. However, there's lots of questions in regards to accountability and transparency in regards to the administration that therefore need to be asked, because as this relationship is going to go forward, obviously, we want to be able to trust the administration in having this new relationship. The fact remains that some of these prisoners, including 14 of them, had been released months, some up to 1 year before the December 17th announcement by the president. One of them actually was rearrested after the president's announcement. Meant beaten and held in a punishment cell for 2 weeks until early January. Thus, obviously, this is a very fickle and fungible agreement in this regard. An administration official said that the list was drafted in June. Well, the list was drafted in June. How come one of them, Carlos Andres Sanchez Perez, was released a year ago? So there's a lot of these questions, I mean, before June. So there's a lot of questions about transparency and frankly, accountability that needs to be asked here. And I think that that's why, to a degree, the administration kept this list secret for all of this time. Because what they wanted to do is be able to, therefore, at the end, describe and explain mission accomplished, quote unquote, in whatever terms they wanted to. Obviously, they're going to have these conversations next week in Havana, and they didn't want to go with all these lingering questions about the whereabouts and the fate of these 53 prisoners. So essentially, this list was fungible the whole time, which is concerning. It should have been released December 17th, and they should have been honest and clear and transparent to the American people about it.
And Mauricio, very briefly, is this not a step that Marie was talking about, that maybe the United States can have now pressure, new pressure on the Castro regime to open up and release maybe more political prisoners?
Well, the other question is why 53 were chosen, because we know of at least 50 more, and we know people that have been arrested since the president's announcement, including a famous artist, Danilo Maldonado, known as El Sexto. Now, what leverage the president has in order to be able to pressure? Obviously, now they think pressure works, and now they're talking about pressure. However, the president doesn't have much more executive power left, since he essentially gave away the farm for this deal in order to pressure the Cuban government. And so, but what we've learned now here is that pressure and leverage, which is what we've argued all along, worked. However, it works when you get a good deal, not when you get a essentially 3-for-1 a spy release and essentially give away all U.S. policy for something that the Cuban government has done often, which is for holding political prisoners as tools of coercion.
Mauricio Clavel, thank you very much for being with me this morning. Appreciate